class. Today we're going to start our second question for our two-question factoring process. We looked in the last video at this first question here of, is there a common factor, and discussed the greatest common factor. Now we're going to move on to the second question in the two-question process, and that is, how many terms are there? How many terms are there will direct us to what do you do next with the problem? And the answer to this question here will either be 2 terms, 3 terms, or 4 terms. We're going to discuss today what you do with 2 terms. In the greatest common factor video, we discussed a little bit about what to do with 4 terms. We're going to discuss more of that when we discuss how to do 3 terms with a leading coefficient that's not 1. So let's take a look at what do you do if your problem has 2 terms. If the problem has 2 terms, there's 3 patterns that can happen, and your problem will always be one of those 3 patterns, and if it's not one of those 3 patterns, you will say that it's prime, which means the only thing that goes into it is 1 in itself. Keep in mind that if you were able to factor out a GCF before you went to the looking at the 2 terms, then it is not technically prime because it had a GCF. However, you're not able to go any farther beyond that. So let's take a look at our first pattern. The first pattern is something that you may have seen when we multiplied binomials. However, you didn't recognize it actually had a name because it was a special pattern. We might have multiplied something in the last chapter, like x plus 5 times x minus 5. When we multiplied this, we FOIled it, and we did x times x and got x squared, and x times negative 5 and got negative 5x. Then we went and did 5 times x to get a positive 5x, and 5 times negative 5 and got a negative 25. And then we noticed that the 2 middle terms were alike and they canceled each other out. So we were left with 2 terms. Now, let's analyze this answer we came up with here and the original problem up here. The answer has 2 terms, and they're not just any 2 terms. They're both perfect squares because this x squared could be broken up into x times x. And this 25 can be broken up into 5 times 5. And perfect squares are numbers that have 2 factors that are exactly the same that can multiply to get that value. So since both of them are perfect squares and they are being subtracted, this solution here is what we call a difference of squares. And this is normally everybody's favorite pattern. Now let's see how this answer down here relates to the original problem, because there's a reason why we ended up with only 2 terms. Notice that the first item in each of these parentheses is x, which is what the square root of this first term is. Notice that the second item in each of these parentheses is 5, which is what the square root of the second term is. The reason why these 2 middle terms canceled out was because one parenthesis had a plus and the other one had a minus. That strategically made it so the middle terms here were identical with opposite signs so that they canceled. So that means that if you have something that is a difference of squares, I'm going to put the general form of the pattern up here. It will have something squared minus something else squared. And to go backwards in your factoring, you'll need to make 2 parentheses. The first item in the parentheses, which will be here and here, will always be this first item factor. If you square root it, it'll be the value that multiplied by itself is this number here. So in this case, it's just x and x. The second item in each of these parentheses will be this second item's square root. So what times itself is this second item, which is in this general form going to be y and y. And one of them will always have a plus and the other one will have a minus. Now it doesn't matter which order these parentheses show up in as long as they are both there, because it doesn't matter what order you multiply in. And that is your pattern. Now, let's take a look at a couple of these. So let's say that you have 4x squared minus 9. Notice that this 4x squared is a 2x times a 2x. So 4x squared is a perfect square because we found something that multiplied by itself is 4x squared. And 9 is 3 times 3, so it is also a perfect square. That means that this is a difference of squares because there's a plus in, or a minus in the middle. If there was a plus in the middle, it would not be a difference of squares. It would be a sum of squares. And a sum of squares is when you have something squared plus something else squared, and this is prime. You cannot factor this at all. Right now, we're going to just say that it's prime, but when we take a look at the next video where you're looking at three terms, I can show you why that is the case. So, since this has the minus, we know it's not prime. We know we can factor it, and it's going to factor into two parentheses with a 2x as our first item in both of them, and a 3 as our second item. One will have a plus and one will have a minus. And this right here is your solution to factoring this expression. Let's look at one that's a little bit disguised. Let's say you have 5x squared minus 20. At first glance, you would say, well, I can't factor that because there's not a perfect square in the first spot here and there's not a perfect square in the second spot. But you've got to remember, every problem has to have this first question asked, and you always need to ask them in this order here. Because once you factor out a common factor, if there is one, you might find that you do have this pattern over here, or one of our other patterns, or that you can actually factor it. So let's first take a look at this and see if there's something in common. And I notice that 5 goes into 5 and 20, so let's factor the 5 out. When you factor the 5 out of 5x squared, you're left with x squared. Factoring a 5 out of a 20 leaves us with a minus 4. Notice that if we look at these two terms now, they now do match our pattern of our difference of squares up here, because x squared is x times x, and 4 is 2 times 2. So we can now factor this farther. You always carry down your greatest common factor, and our two parentheses will have an x as the first item and a 2 as the second item. To follow the pattern, you need to have one with a plus and one with a minus. And that factors out this particular expression. Now, if you don't have a difference of squares, you could still have two terms and be able to factor the expression. There are two other patterns besides the difference of squares and a sum of squares, which is prime. The next one is what we call a difference of cubes. And then we also have a sum of cubes. And the key thing is, with cubes, if you know one of these patterns, you basically know the other one because they are both very, very similar to each other. Now, with cubes, instead of looking for an item that's being squared, so you're looking for something that multiplied by itself is the value, you're going to be looking for something multiplied by itself three times. So, for instance, if you had 2 cubed, that would be 2 times 2 times 2, which is 8. It is very helpful to know what the cubes are to help you know whether you have a cube or not for either of these patterns. So what I would suggest, if you're not familiar with the cubes, which most people are less familiar with them than the squares, I would list down the side of your paper 1 cubed is 1, 2 cubed is 8, 3 cubed is 27, 4 cubed is 64, 5 cubed is 125, 6 cubed is 216, and 7 cubed is 343. Having those handy will help you recognize whether you have a cube or not. You can just look and see if you have one of these numbers, which are called perfect cubes, over here. Notice once we got up to 7 cubed, we got to a very large number. It's normally pretty good if you know up to that value. We rarely see many in our problems for this course that are higher than 7 cubed. So now that we know what the cubes are, a difference of cubes would be something cubed minus something else cubed. A sum of cubes is going to be something cubed plus something else cubed. Now the pattern for these is very similar. You're going to go through a process. Rather than memorizing the pattern, I would memorize the process, because if you know the process on one of them, you know the process on the other. And we're going to go through that process. You are going to have two sets of parentheses, and notice my second one is larger than my first one. And I put the first one directly under the general form because we're going to actually get it from that general form. So you first cube root this, which means you look for the item times itself three times that is that, which is x, and cube root this, and then carry down your sign. And you do that for both of them. So this second one, because there's a plus, will be x plus y instead of x minus y. Then what we do is for this first spot in the second parentheses, you square this first item. So that'll be x squared. You also square the y for the last spot. And even if it's a minus y, negative times negative is positive, so this is always a plus. And then the second item squared. The same thing happens here. We get x squared and y squared, and the y squared always has a plus. Now for the middle item over here, because there's three terms in this second one, you take these first two terms, ignoring the sign, and you multiply them together. So we're going to get an xy here in both of them. Now we need to know if the xy has a plus or a minus in front of it. Well, if this is a minus here, then this will be a plus. If this is a plus here, this will be a minus, because those are always opposites. So since those are opposites, if you know one pattern, you know the other, because the only difference in them is that this one had a minus here, so it had a plus over here. This one had a plus here, so it had a minus over here. And that's the only difference. Now, let's take a look at a problem that is cubes. Let's say that we have w cubed plus 125. Notice that since this w is cubed, we want to look on the cube list to see if we have a perfect cube for this other number here, and notice that 125 is 5 cubed. So the w is w times w times w, and the 125 is 5 times 5 times 5. So this is our sum of cubes right here. And we're going to follow that pattern. So for our first parentheses here, we're going to carry down the w from this item, and the 5 from this item. And because there's a plus here, this will be w plus 5. Now let's create our second parentheses by using our first parentheses. square your w for right here, which will be w squared. Square your 5 back here, which will be positive 25, because 5 times 5. Then for the middle term, we're going to multiply the w and the 5 together to get a 5w. And finally, since this was a plus here, we will put a minus right there. And that gives us the factored form of that sum of cubes. Let's look at one more that might be slightly disguised, and I'm going to erase a little bit this so we can keep what we have up here and do the next problem. Let's say that we actually have 16x cubed minus 54. Now you see the x cubed in this, and at first you say, oh, this should be that cubes pattern. However, then you look at this 16 and the 54 and you say, well, that's not on our cubes list, so this must be prime. We can't do anything. But you've got to remember, you always have to ask your first question. Is there something in common? And I notice that 16 and 54 both have a 2 in common. Always factor out your GCF first. Once we factor out a 2, we're left with 8x cubed minus 27, and that is a difference of cubes, so now we can factor it. You always carry your GCF down, and then let's make our two parentheses. The first parentheses will be created from here. 8x cubed is 2x times 2x times 2x, so we will put a 2x here. We carry down our minus, and 27 is 3 times 3 times 3, so we will put a 3 here. Now let's create our second parentheses. Square your 2x for here. 2x times 2x is 4x squared. Square your 3 for here, and 3 times 3 is 9. And we always have a plus there, because positive times positive is positive, and so is negative times negative. Now, we multiply these together, and 2x times 3 is 6x. And since this was a minus, this will be a plus. And that is our solution. You want the entire line here of 2 times the parentheses 2x minus 3 times the parentheses 4x squared plus 6x plus 9. And that is how you deal with two terms. You want to make sure you have one of these three patterns. If you don't have one of those three patterns, then you would be finished with your problem.